you're joined with God's people, and we together celebrate the promises and presence of our Lord as we gather to worship. Bless you. And kindly share in that blessing by using the friendship pads as a way of helping better connect us. If you would, please, we really try to be mindful of all the special folk with us on any given morning. And if you're joining us via streaming, you can be very cozy and comfortable and still in your PJs, and we are thrilled that you would take these moments to be with us. We have a couple of things we'd like to highlight, remembering that the training day for IHN, the Interfaith Hospitality Network, will be next Sunday at noon in the Fellowship Hall. This will help us do a better job of sharing in this ministry, which responds to those in our immediate vicinity who presently are homeless. Be a part of the large group that'll embrace that time together. Matthew 25, our service together is on Saturday the 27th from 11 to 1. A special concert Friday night. This Friday night, the 19th, 7 p.m., Soo Jin Kim will play the arrangements of Mark Hayes in Piano Praise, accompanied by her husband and guest bassoonist, Noel Garcia. What a gift you all are. And here's a special invite from Rebecca Bebahani, our Director of Family Ministry.
Morning, what a great day to worship together. In 2 weeks, on October 28th, we get to host our second annual Trunk or Treat. And last year, we saw close to 200 people. And this year, we were fortunate enough to be able to send out 500 postcards to the neighborhoods around us. So we know that we're probably going to have a really big turnout of families coming to Sycamore. And we want to show off who we are. We want to show off everyone that is here, this great intergenerational family that we have created here at Sycamore. So we need your help to make this successful. We need you to host a trunk. And that's pretty easy because you can have a car or a truck or an RV, an SUV, a bike. If you want a table and chairs, we'll set that up. We just need you to be there to hand out treats to kids. Zach, do you like candy?
Yeah.
Is that what you love about Trunk or Treat? Yes. So that's what the kids want to do. They want to dress up and they want to come and get treats and they want to meet the people at Sycamore. I didn't even train him. So we need you to host. So you can sign up in whatever spot that you want. We're going to be out by the storage barn in the manse. And if you have friends that you want to do this together, you guys can sign up together. Decorate and hand out treats. We have lunch provided. We'll have games and pumpkin painting. And if you haven't guessed yet, we have some special Star Wars characters that will be here taking pictures and have lightsabers for people. They'll be real ones, not like the ones from the video, like real people that do this for their job. So we hope that you will sign up. This is out in the cafe. If you need somebody to set up a table and chairs for you because you don't want to bring your car or don't have a car, just put a star by it and we'll make sure that it's there. So please come 2 weeks, October 28th, and join in Trunk or Treat. Thanks.
Thank you.
Please join me in the call to worship. We will give thanks to you, O Lord, with all our hearts. Because of your love and faithfulness. Bless the Lord. Never beyond the reach of God's grace, care, love, encouragement, and forgiveness. So with that in mind, together let us pray the prayer of confession. Merciful God, you call, but we seldom hear. You beckon, yet we turn away. Sin keeps us from responding to you. And so often we seem incapable of doing good. Forgive our lack of attention to things that matter. Focus us on your call to worship and service. Release us from all that prevents us from being the people you would have us be, so that we may choose the path that points in the way of Jesus Christ, whose love is stronger than death. May we continue with a moment of personal confession. God is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. God reaches out to us again and again that we may turn away from what is destructive and turn toward what is life-giving. God reaches out to us with forgiveness, assuring us that we are beloved children of God and equipping us to serve God and our neighbor in the world. God forgives us, encourages us, and frees us to love others. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. Seated. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, verses 31 to 34. Hear God's word as I share it with you. Jesus took the 12 aside and told them, "We are going up to Jerusalem, and everything that is written by the prophets about the Son of Man will be fulfilled. He will be handed over to the Gentiles. They will mock him, insult him, and spit on him, flog him, and kill him. On the third day, he will rise again." The disciples did not understand any of this. Its meaning was hidden from them, and they did not know what he was talking about. The word of the Lord.
You
This is a wonderful day in the life of our church family, especially because Angie and Seth Johnston are presenting their son, Nolan Robert, for baptism this morning. Please come forward. Oh, yeah, let's make it a family affair. Yes. Here we go, old buddy. Hi, bud. How are you? Yes. Jesus said, bring the little ones to me, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. In baptism, our Lord places a sign on us to show that we belong to him. And he gives us his Holy Spirit as a guarantee that sharing in Christ's reconciling work in human life, we will also share in his victory. And that dying with Christ to sin will be raised with him to new life. And so Angie and Seth, in presenting Nolan for baptism, you announce your faith in our Lord Jesus, and you show how you want him and Emma and Grace to grow to know and love and serve our Lord as part of the family. And so we invite you to show your purpose by answering these questions. Do you acknowledge Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Do you trust in him?
Yes.
Do you intend your children, and this day, Nolan, to be his disciple, to obey his word, and to show his love? Dear friends, what a privilege. Do you, the people of the church, pledge to do all that you can to help this child and this family know the good news of the gospel, to enable them to experience and feel all what Christ commands, and by your fellowship, to strengthen their sense of belonging by your love and encouragement and support? Will you answer in the affirmative by saying, we will?
We will.
And you bet we will. Lots of exciting things to look at. Dear Nolan Robert Johnston, child of God, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and dwell in your heart forever. Amen. This child is received, welcomed, embraced as a part of Christ's holy, loving, worldwide family, which we call the Church of our Lord Jesus. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and we are. Will you pray with me? Faithful Lord, may we sense the goodness of your care always, and bless Angie and Seth, that they may love with your love and teach your truth, that together as a family they would celebrate belonging together because they belong to you through Christ Jesus, our loving and eternal Lord, we pray and give thanks. Amen. Bless you. Thank you. Will you please pray with me? As only you can, dearest Lord, love us and lead us and make us your own, to the glory of Christ Jesus, our loving Lord. Amen. I want to thank those of you who made it a point to share with me that you identified with my most recent line from Larry in the newsletter, where I talked about the unexpected group that was camped briefly at the adjacent remote campsite when I was on a study break in September. And if none of this really makes a whole lot of sense to you right now, let me encourage you to read the newsletter if you don't do it routinely. I think you'll find there to be lots of good information and some things that will bless you and lift your spirit. I'd gone, as I typically do, to try to prepare a series. This series would be for January, February, and the beginning of March. And it would be on the theme of simplify your life. I can tell you that the act of working on that was very influential to me. Made me evaluate a whole number of things. And I was grateful for the opportunity. Normally, people would refer to this as a personal retreat, and although that's fair, it's always work-related. I go with a couple of books that I endeavor to read, and in the course of those four nights away, I generally will frame one or two sermon series with themes for each week, the appropriate scriptures, and maybe a few illustrations. And so I always pick the most remote campsite possible, and most often there's absolutely nobody there. Unlike on a vacation where you may choose when you're going to get up and see what you feel like, I try to make it a discipline to get up every day before the sun is up and take a walk. Usually it's 4 miles, and I do that most recently with our trusted rescue Beagle Basset mix named Vinny, who accompanies me. He is on duty 24/7 guarding against intruding rabbits and squirrels. So I'm safe. A little ways into the walk, I'll stop at a convenience store / gas station in the little village of Grand Rapids, Ohio, on the banks of the Maumee River, and grab a cup of coffee and pick up a Toledo Blade. When I was a child, I read the Toledo Blade. I still do, and with pleasure. When we get back finally to the campsite, the discipline is to read the scriptures for the day in the 2-year Bible, which I use. After that, I'll make breakfast. Now, you get the excitement of all this. Can make a few eggs and toast generally, and some might say, well, how do you make toast without a toaster? Well, that's what a frying pan is for. And then after making another cup of coffee, which to the delight of Tim and my colleagues is always of the instant variety, I start reading. And I'll read through the morning, and I'll read into the afternoon, and if I get tired, I'll take a nap, but that's hard to do when it's really hot. And I'll keep reading through the afternoon and into the early evening, and maybe around 6 o'clock, I'll reward myself with a glass of red wine and keep reading. Now, I have to figure out what I'm going to do for dinner. Sometimes I'll grill. Sometimes I will pick up takeout from that little village and go back to the campsite and keep reading. In fact, I'll read until it's dark, so it really pays to have a good campfire. And here's a proof that I actually do read in the dark. What a handsome photo. And usually by this time of night, Vinny wants to go in the tent and leave me out there. So we'll go in, and I may keep reading for a little while longer. No, it is short on excitement, but it's long on peace and purpose and being able to be productive, at least for me. And it was on such a leave in May that I was working on this present series called More Than a Carpenter. So you can tell I try to work about 4 or 5 months out so that there's a plan for moving forward and some of the things that we'll seek to highlight. And I knew that much of this would be very challenging. As we think about some of the related aspects to this theme, more than a carpenter. You know, we've looked at a name that causes problems, as we talked about the name of Jesus. We focused on, is he who he says he is, or is he crazy? We looked at, what about when scientific proof isn't enough? Tim helped us look at the reliability of Scripture and the God-breathed truth. Last week, we looked at who would lie about a dead Savior. And today, we're looking at, it's that Messiah piece that I really don't understand. It would have been a little different for us if we'd grown up Jewish. The concept of the Messiah would have been built into the framework of our collective experience and knowledge base and expectation. The Messiah has been anticipated by the Jewish people for centuries, and Jesus would embody it and give it a whole nother dimension of meaning. I've chosen to borrow from a writer, Josh McDowell, who borrowed from other folk to try to grasp what the corporate understanding of Messiah was within the framework of Jesus' life. And here are a couple of things I felt were worth sharing. A suffering Messiah was completely foreign to the Jewish conception of Messiahship. And then secondly, in the light of the gospel references, it can hardly be doubted that the popular conception of the Messiah was mainly national and political. The messianic hope was basically for a national liberation. It's helpful to remember that the Jewish people had been overrun time and time again by the armies of other nations. Going back many centuries, the Assyrians did it, the Babylonians did it. Most recently, the Romans had done it and occupied that Jewish homeland. And what they were yearning for was a four-star general, a dynamo of deliverance. As it was in Jesus' day, they wanted someone to kick the hated Romans out of their land and restore them to a place of prominence on the world stage. It shouldn't be lost on any of us that when Jesus goes into Jerusalem, he goes riding on a donkey, not on a white stallion. He's not this conquering warrior as they have anticipated. He will not rule from a large, pompous throne. He will lead his people from a cross that is dripping with his own blood. He will be the suffering servant, the one who so identifies with the brokenness of his people that he will pay any price to love them and to redeem them. And that is the act of Calvary, but it's not what people had anticipated. How like God to show up in ways which are beyond our anticipation. We feel like we've got the script down pretty neatly. In fact, sometimes we will pray, Lord, I'd like you to show up this way and take care of this in a particular manner. We miss the point. This God is so often the God of the unexpected moment. He is bigger than any of our limited conceptions. He weaves his care into the fabric of human life in ways that defy our own limitations. And so this Lord is able to be present in ways which catch us off guard, just as in Jesus' day they were not ready for a Messiah like this. It didn't fit the mold. God's love and grace is bigger than any mold. And it ought to hearten us that in the middle of some of the trials that you and I experience, they may be, in essence, setting the stage for a wondrous work of God in our life. You know, the very thing we wish wouldn't happen, the things that we want to just go away, somehow become vehicles that the Lord can infuse with a special presence and purpose that draw us to a place we could have never gotten to in life outside of his miraculous and wondrous care. Sadly, we limit ourselves because we want to figure it all out and then control it. But God's ways are not our ways. They're better than our ways. And they're also more dependably gracious and loving and upbuilding and life-giving than we are ever capable of orchestrating. So Jesus as Messiah was something that defied the previous experience of the people. Jesus shows up in a way in which they don't expect. I'm often struck how the Lord will use circumstances of even pain and brokenness to perhaps move the needle in a direction where it needs to go. Some of you have been just so attentive to something I shared on email as a part of the prayer chain a few days ago. Joyce has really two aunts. One is 99, and she's in the Dayton area. The other one is 100. That's the one I'm referring to. Her name is Paula. She lives in the greater Toledo area, but sadly, she has been in a facility which is a place where she doesn't want to be. And she's been very upfront with us about it. We had nothing to do with her being there. She has three sons. None of them live even in the state. So she has often felt kind of alone there. And every time I go on one of these study breaks, I go to see her. She's only about 20 miles from where I camp. She's always regarded my wife Joyce as being her daughter. She has three boys, and she had a daughter who died in childbirth. So there's a real closeness there. Well, a week ago, Paula fell and broke her pelvis. That's never good. It's especially not good if you're 100. And the surgeon was so upset, he said, "I cannot operate. What I can do is to say that if she could lie on her back for an entire month, at 3 months she might be able to be weight bearing. And to some of us, that's just over and out, death sentence, pneumonia." They couldn't keep her in the hospital, so they transported her to hospice. Well, many of us will, in a very limited way, say, "Well, there you go." Not necessarily. In fact, to date, that's kind of been her experience. We had learned that she really wasn't eating well in her previous placement. Short-staffed, weren't real attentive. In hospice, oh my, she's eating really well. Sounds like she even likes the food. She's very alert, says she's not in pain. Is so appreciative of all the company that's come to see her. She's already got 1 week in. Here's a picture of Paula that Joyce received last evening. She takes no meds, generally. She hardly uses glasses. She's a beautiful lady, has a dark wit, and she's doing much better in hospice. Now, I know she may live another day. She may live another year. I would never count this lady out. But I will tell you this, she is so much happier now than she has been in recent years. All because of a fractured pelvis that somehow became the conduit for her to leave where she didn't want to be into a place where she would receive a better level of care and be encouraged and feel better and much brighter. How the Lord is able to work through the challenge and brokenness of our lives is so much a God-driven thing, but it is there. God consistently and dependably shows up in ways in which we don't expect, and always to bless us. And to remind us that this Jesus, who is the Christ, is Jesus who is the Messiah. Messiah in Hebrew means Christ in Greek. And he is the Lord of all time and place. And never doubt what he wants to do, what he's able to do in your life and mine to the glory of God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Amen.
Please be seated. We have the privilege of being able to spend time talking with the creator of the universe, the sustainer of the universe, the one who loves us and redeems us, who welcomes our prayers and works through them. With that in mind, let us pray. Again, we rejoice in the worship of you alone, Heavenly Father. Even in the rain on a cloudy and cool day, we know you are with us, with your love and grace warms our souls. And whether the sun is shining in our lives or we are passing through times of darkness and struggle, we rejoice that you are with us. And as we seek to raise a church, we pray for your insight, your continued insight, wisdom, encouragement, and grace so to do. We seek this mission to expand and build your kingdom, not for our glory, but for yours. And so we pray our hearts would continue to be open as you lead us into new and challenging areas and outreach. Remind us that our mission is not about an organization, but about your kingdom and everlasting life. And so for this reason, we continue to pray for the leadership of Sycamore, particularly the elders, deacons, and trustees. Hear, we pray, our silent and individual prayer for those who lead us. And there are others who serve so well, so meaningfully. They serve on committees, they teach, they help organize. Hear us as we silently give you thanks for those who serve so well. We thank you for unexpected blessings, like a new roof that costs us nothing. We pray for the safety of those who are working on the roof. We thank you for your provision, and we pray that you would bring it, as you bring it to completion, that even something as significant and in many ways as simple as a new roof would build your kingdom. And we remember those that we may know who are ill, those who are recovering, perhaps from illness or surgery, those who we know who are homebound. Hear our silent prayers for them. And as we rejoice in this time together, this worship shared, fellowship shared, we know that as we go into the coming week, that you know what lays ahead of us. We only know this moment and can only see that far. We know there will be times where we need your wisdom, your grace. We know that we will fall short, and so in those times, help us to rely completely in your forgiveness. And we may also have very specific concerns for this coming week, so hear us as we silently pray for these things. And as your people, we rejoice that you hear all prayer, spoken and unspoken. And hear us as together we pray the prayer that your Son and our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Should you like additional prayer, we have a prayer team who are delighted to pray with you following the service. You may remain in your where you're seated or come forward, and they will be happy to share a time of prayer with you.
During this season of stewardship, we're looking at the theme of living a giving life. And each week we are seeking to highlight a ministry area that will be supported by the 2019 ministry plan, otherwise known as the budget. And since we work off of a balanced budget, it's exceedingly important for people to have information about the things that are happening in our life and work. One of our newest ministries is also clearly one of the most innovative and influential, our family ministry. And here to speak to us a little bit about who they are and what they're doing is Elder Brian Fisher. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. As Larry said, my name is Brian Fisher, and I work with elders Betty Kratz and Rhonda Augustine on family ministries. And our motto is, let's raise a church. And our motto is based upon three main pillars. We inspire, we connect, we serve. Family Ministries Inspires. Betty, Rhonda, and I have the privilege of working with three of our staff, Rhonda, Jan, and Drew. And I'm here to tell you they are motivated and enthusiastic to inspire our children, students, and families to live as disciples of Christ through worship and prayer. I would ask that you please join Brenda and me and increase your pledge this year by 10% so we can realize the request by the personnel committee to give our staff the 5% salary increase that they have earned. Secondly, Family Ministries Connects. We connect generations together through study, worship, and fellowship, both within this church and within our community. Two examples. Last summer at Vacation Bible School, 100 children participated in that program, and over half of those were not associated with Sycamore Church. Second example, Trunk or Treat, coming up in 2 weeks that Rebecca spoke about. Last year, over 200 of our community participants came to that event. These programs, along with the programs on Sunday mornings and throughout the week, could not happen without your support. We appreciate your gifts of time, your gifts of talent, and germane for today, your gifts of treasure. Thirdly, Family Ministries Serve. We are called to serve others in Christ's name. Family Ministries does things like host families for Matthew 25 Ministries. We sponsor student mission trips, like last summer. They went to Gary, West Virginia. And we're looking for ways of being able to market into our community to attract new families. Inspire, connect, serve. God has provided us with many gifts and blessings. As our blessings increase, so do our responsibilities. Please consider your many blessings that God has given you as you prayerfully consider your pledge. Thank you.
We celebrate that pledging giving is a spiritual discipline, and we remind ourselves of the biblical standard to strive to tithe and to work in a way that allows us to move closer and closer toward that most important and faithful goal. Your officers have made it a point to pledge early as a way of encouraging the whole church family. 100% of our elders have already pledged, and a majority of our deacons and trustees have also pledged. And here are a couple of numbers that I think you will appreciate, especially since we are still 1 week out from Commitment Sunday, which is the day when we ask that all the pledges be turned in. $188,000 from your officers already, and then $490,000 already pledged. You can pledge online, you can bring a pledge card next week, or you can drop it off during the week. It is a privilege to support the movement of God in human life. And next week, to kind of bring all this together, we're going to have a special reception, and you're going to want to hang around and be a part of that, or come a little early for it, because you'll be glad you did. But remember, this is an act of our whole church family, and strive to be timely, because it becomes impossible for your officers to set a budget until we've heard from everyone, and every gift is important. Bless you, friends.
And now, friends, as only you can, go with joy. Live in faith. Believe that life is good. And if you find it not, help make it so, to the glory of God who made us. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship, friendship, and power of the Holy Spirit lead us forward together each step of the way. Amen.